We're going to start with motivating where we think we really are in kind of like the revolution of computing, which is a pretty big place to start. Of course, we had the desktop computer, which was sort of like the forerunner of everything we're going to talk about. We are living through the mobile revolution, and everybody in this room has an incredibly powerful sensing and compute platform in their pocket. In fact, raise your hand if you don't. Exactly. And this is where we think it's going. And it's really interesting to think about the fact that virtual reality, augmented reality, and in general, wearable devices actually are with us today. They're just not the paradigm that we're used to. And there's a big reason for that, because the capabilities we need to develop don't exist in the forms that we need them to. So we're part of a revolution, all of us here, and we've all been part of it, you know, for the last 60-odd years. Now, everyone will have heard a little bit about the metaverse, so I'll just quote here our CTO. You know, the defining quality of the metaverse will be presence, the feeling of really being there with people. And, you know, Reality Labs, that's our group at Meta, has been focused on building products that deliver presence across digital spaces for years. So again, this is not something that we're not used to. When we went from sort of like having to pick up a telephone to being able to chat through web and, you know, basically today where, you know, calls and we've all been through 2 years worth of using video chats, presence and connecting people across the planet, you know, has really been the mission at Meta for a long time. Now, presence comes in a couple of forms, and our research teams have been working on both of them. Perhaps the more obvious one that our teams have been known for in the past is the kind of presence that builds reconstructions of real environments and ultimately allows people to connect across spaces. And this is going to be really instrumental so it can move past the sort of 2D video screens. Now here we see, you know, Boz and his dad, you know, in a reconstruction of his dad's living room. And, you know, it really can have presence in this sense, and it's coming soon. But at the other end of the spectrum is the concept that, you know, we live our lives in these mobile phones looking downwards. And so, in a sense, you're not really in reality when you're looking down at your mobile phone. So what would happen if we can start to bring you back into this reality and actually enhance it? And that's the work that we've been working towards with Project Aria. Now, you know, you can try and envisage what you would do if you had a supercomputer on your face that could understand the world better than you do, before you do, and anticipate your needs. But the problem is there is an egocentric AI gap to enabling these VR, AR, and wearable devices in the ways that we want to. And that's because, you know, the form factors like the glasses I'm wearing have limited space for compute, sensing, and so on. So this egocentric AI gap led to our team about 5 years ago developing the concept of live maps, which we talked about a couple of years ago. And the idea is that devices like this can't do all the sensing, you know, on the actual device themselves. You're going to have to build essentially a cache of reality, a map of reality, and keep it up to date with all the things that the device is going to need to know. And this will be private to the user, where things need to be private, and things that can be shared in public can be shared in public. And we're very used to this today with effectively maps of the world for use in navigation. Now, the kind of map we're talking about is a live and dynamically updating, predictive, physically predictive model of reality that we call live maps. Where's the data going to come from to build this map? Well, if we think about the kind of maps that exist for navigation, so that your mobile phone doesn't need to scan its surroundings and go, oh, you know, I'm 50 meters from a coffee shop and I need to turn in that direction, that would be absurd, of course. You know, then we had, first of all, a revolution in sensing from satellites. And this allowed us to essentially build maps of the planet Earth at, you know, fidelities of meters. And on top of that, we started to be able to augment that data with the road networks and the polygons that represent places in the world. And from that, you can get navigation and various other actually forms of augmented reality that enhance our lives every day. Okay, after satellites, you've already seen fleets of cars, and these are important for maps that are, of course, used for your mobile phones, but also used for self-driving cars. And those fleets of cars, you will be seeing them everywhere if you're in parts of cities that have got self-driving car teams. And that gets you higher fidelity at higher rates of update of those maps. And that's important. But it certainly isn't sufficient from a point of view of the egocentric AI that we need in our homes and in our offices, et cetera, every day. You know, finally, we saw, you know, people with backpacks, and you know, our teams and others around the world have been researching this kind of building maps with backpacks. And that gets you a bit further. You can go into malls, you can certainly get closer to the shops and so on, and you can keep the data rates flowing. But realistically, this is nowhere near getting at the data rates needed and the quality and fidelity of everyday life experiences. Of course it can't. You can't go into your own home with a satellite or a car or a backpack. So instead, we think the next leap in data collection is effectively wearable form factors. Now, the kinds of data that you get from wearable form factors look like this. They're your everyday existence, and they are so plural in their experience or your experience that to try and imagine the kinds of data that you collect, all we can do is go and collect it and start looking at it. And therein lies essentially some significant challenges. The unique challenges are that when we start to think about data and collecting data of this sort, well, the scale, the scene diversity is unprecedented. So if you're in self-driving cars, cities look like cities. In certain parts of the world, they look like different parts of the world. But realistically, wherever you go as a human is really wherever humans have ever gone and ever will go, and that is far more diverse. And the scale of that kind of data is unprecedented. Together with that, we have limits on the amount of compute that we can put on a capture device that's going to be in the wild. We have limits on the kind of fields of view and the data rates that can be collected because of thermal limits on a device that's in the wild. We have problems that come from basically having motion blur. As you move your head at up to 800 degrees per second, basically that data that you're used to when you're looking at nice images from Instagram that are feeding the current streams of machine perception and artificial intelligence don't look like that anymore. And what's more, they're from this egocentric view, and people don't really understand that egocentric data, which is what you're used to with your brain, is not what it looks like to pose a nice photo with the object in the center. That's really not what most of us see all the time. It's not what our devices will see. So the data has problems for these reasons. On top of that, there are concepts of frames of reference. So, there's my body frame of reference, there's this desk frame of reference, this conference room frame of reference. If I'm in a lift, the visual and the inertial frame of reference are not even the same. And that's true if you're in a plane, a car, an automobile, et cetera. That produces problems for our machine perception. And finally, and perhaps most uniquely, this data is incredibly personal. That is to say, who's going to allow the collection of data in homes? Who's going to allow the collection of data of bystanders? And so we have to solve these problems if you want to build data sets and do research of data in the wild. So all of these problems have to be solved, and I guess this is why we're all here today. We don't really know how to solve all these problems and enable the machine perception and the AI that egocentric gap has. Now, if we have a look at the opportunities that have existed previously, you've got these incredible devices, HoloLens and Quest. And these devices, do have rich sensor suites. But the form factors don't let you wear them all day. They're about 400 to 600 grams. If you try and wore a Quest, for more than an hour or two, you'd know that you wouldn't want to wear it much longer. But they've got the right kind of sensors. Now, on the other hand, you've got GoPros and, people doing action recording. No, you can put one on your head and go skiing downhill. And there are things like Vuzix and so on. But they typically don't have the rich sensor suites that we need for developing the next generation of egocentric AI. So there's a gap right there, and we need to fill it. And that's exactly what Aria is. It's a dedicated research tool for collection in always-on settings with a form factor that you can wear all day long. It's there to help us solve these problems in research first, so that then the ultimate devices that we're going to be wearing in our products actually have some of the answers solved before we get there in the market. That's very important, especially for those areas of privacy and security of that kind of data. Okay, a quick deep dive into Aria. There's three core components. It's not just a device, it's also a companion app that allows us to control the device, and it's also secure storage and services. So the device itself, glasses form factor, and I'm sure we've got a device that we could pass around today, so if we want to pass that around. It's got Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and GPS. It's got SLAM cameras, two of them. It's got a high resolution, effectively a GoPro camera in there. It's got dual IMUs, a barometer, and inertial units, magnetometers, 7 microphones, spatial microphone arrays, very unique kind of data platform for audio, and eye tracking, a big compute unit, and a big battery that allows us to have really configurable sensing profiles that can be used for various different sorts of research purposes. So if you need high frame rate with eye tracking versus just audio and just location, that can be configured in Aria. Okay, second, the companion app. Basically, we needed a way to control a device. Aria doesn't have a display, but your mobile phone is a pretty good display, and it's a pretty good unit for interaction. And so we use this mobile phone today with a companion app for Aria. It allows for intuitive and easy low-friction control of the unit. It allows data to be uploaded once the device is plugged in. So only when you plug the device in will it connect to Wi-Fi and start to do the upload. That makes sure that the power and the battery in the device is just used for the data recording. And the device has been designed predominantly for Meta researchers and our partners in university vendors, and it is not designed for consumers. So this is a research vehicle, not a consumer product. Okay, here's a quick snapshot of using Aria for the purposes of basically showing that, you know, there's a human going about their daily business. This is Renzo, the chief architect of Aria, and, you know, doing his daily chores, putting the books away. And with Aria, you start to see this egocentric view. So on the left, you see what really the cameras see, and you see that in the end, you know, from the third-person perspective, the exocentric perspective, very different sort of data. Now, what we've got is just showing the trajectory of the head, which comes from the SLAM cameras and the inertial units with basically visual inertial odometry and SLAM. Okay, finally, what about the security of this data? Did you just like download the data or stick it on a server and allow anyone to see it? No, it's very important that we've got a process here where we can say, you know, if you're out in the wild, you know, walking past Walmart and somebody wants their data not to be recorded in your research data sets, that we're able to effectively follow a process where, number one, we can say, in all honesty, that a best effort to anonymize the data, so faces, number plates, and other forms of PII data are coming to be removed. So this is the privacy filter stage. And then following a quarantine stage, where for up to 72 hours, there's a process where we can delete basically the data from the companion app before it's really secured into what is a secure storage on our servers. And then the researchers have access via access control protocols, so that the types of data that they should have access to has some sort of process associated with it. Not everyone should have access to all kinds of data, so we need to put a process in place. Okay. So with that, effectively, we also have to think about the innovation, the responsible innovation that was necessary to develop something like Aria and allow it to start to scale, you know, both inside of Meta with research teams and also externally with partners in universities and industry. So we take our responsible innovation principles very seriously. We make sure that we've got the best state-of-the-art, you know, anonymization technology, although this is an absolutely crucial area of research in and of itself. And we have a process to ensure that people, at least initially, whilst we ramp up what data collection with these kinds of egocentric devices look like, when in public, have a procedure that they can follow to basically make themselves, you know, aware to, or make people aware that they're in their domain, and also be able to answer the questions and allow them to have like obvious answers to how this data is being used, how it can be controlled and deleted, etc. And thank you, everybody, for joining us. Really excited to have you here. Please enjoy the tutorial.